with Scripts and Scribes, and we are at the Writers Guild Festival 2016, and we are speaking with Mark Guggenheim, who is executive producer of both Legends of Tomorrow. That's for some reason I keep wanting to say Legends of Zelda, but it's Legends of Tomorrow.
That would be awesome. I would totally show on that show. That'd be awesome.
And Arrow, which obviously very successful work.
Thanks.
Congratulations on everything.
Thank you very much. It's good to be talking with you.
Yes. I'm so interested in how people kind of get their break and how they get started in the industry, because a lot of our audience are aspiring writers and people who are really trying to. So if you wouldn't mind sharing kind of...
I can totally share. How are we sharing?
You can hold this if you want.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Yeah, I have my own, so you're good.
Oh, you're all set then. Oh, what do you need? What do you need this for? What was the question?
Just kind of what was your process of getting into the industry? You know, how'd you break in?
Well, I'll tell you. I mean, I will also say this was this is around 16 years ago when I broke in. So I think things have changed a lot. But basically, the short version is I was in my third year of law school. My brother Eric was in his senior year of film school. He asked if I would write a script with him. Because he actually wanted to be a director, but he felt like, I should write a script to get a sense as to what that process is like. So we wrote a script together, and I really got bit by the bug and really wanted to do more of it. So Eric and I wrote a few scripts together. He graduated, I graduated, I went off to practice law. He went to go look for a job, and he sent out a bunch of letters. This is, just as email is in its infancy. He sent out a bunch of letters, right? A long time ago.
Yeah.
In one of the letters to a management company, he had said he basically wanted a job at the management company. He didn't want a manager, but he happened to mention that one of the things he had just done was finish a script with his brother Mark. And the person he'd written the letter to, or who had read the letter, said, we don't have any jobs open, but I'd be interested in reading your script. So he sent it, and she signed us as clients of the management company. And that's how...
That's amazing.
It's kind of amazing.
Yeah.
It's kind of amazing. And it all, she actually turned out, eventually they married my brother and his manager, Lisa. So everything was sort of meant to be. And when he actually came out here to take meetings off of a spec he wrote by himself, in one of his first meetings, he sold a pitch. And that was his first, paid work as a writer.
Wow.
So, a lot of luck. And also the industry was a different thing,
Mm-hmm.
I'm a very big believer that, and when I think about my own career, even though I broke in 16 years ago and been writing for 5 years before that, I felt sort of like, you take enough bites at the apple and you start to see little indications of potential success. Someone read your script and liked it, or you got an important meeting, or you got an opportunity to pitch on something, and even if you didn't sell the pitch, it was a helpful stepping stone, and sort of like, it's like you're cracking away at the wall, and eventually things do fall into place. And my favorite saying about Hollywood is it takes years to become an overnight success. Those years have gotten longer and longer, but I'm a big believer that, eventually things do work out for you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that that's a nice thing to hear, especially for people who may not be at that point yet. They're just trying, and it was nice to hear you say that you were also writing for 5 years before.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's an overnight success is not necessarily overnight.
I think a lot of times people, they'll write a script and then they'll put all their energy or a good chunk of their energy into, into finding a manager or an agent. And if you got the good samples, eventually finding a manager or an agent it'll just happen. You've got to hone your craft. It's focusing on that. I know one of the other panelists, Aaron talked about how, when he was an assistant, once he stopped focusing on what everyone else was doing or not doing, he found success. I agree with that in spades. I think you really just write. Because the truth of the matter is, as a showrunner during staffing season, I read a lot of scripts. And they're scripts by people who are represented. And the truth is, there's not that many good writers out there. And, it, you know, in an age of incompetence, being competent makes you extraordinary. And it being actually genuinely talented, I don't even know how to describe that. So, if you know, just keep honing your craft and working away at it, and eventually things will happen for you.
So I'm curious then, as you're reading these scripts, you know, what is it that you notice? I mean, obviously, you know, being a competent writer, maybe understanding the structure or the voice, but what is it that you're, you know, what are the main qualities that are important to you or that stand out?
Well, definitely voice. I always feel like I'm hiring a writer really for their voice. I think anyone, fundamentally, when you strip everything away, writers get hired for their voice. And it's finding out what you have to say as a writer that's so important when you're starting out. And it's not just what you say, but it's how you say it. What is the thing that makes your script uniquely your script? You know, like I'm, you know, my brother Eric is, you know, also went on to become a professional screenwriter. My brother David also has done that. And even though we're all brothers, you can literally like look at all three, you know, scripts from all three of us without title pages, and you'll know who wrote what, because each one of us has a voice. And that fundamentally, that's the calling card. People think your calling card as a writer is your sample or your spec. It's not. It's your voice. The sample or your spec is just the instrument by which your voice gets conveyed.
So I, sorry if this is a weird question, but do you have any tips for improving your individual voice? Because I think that a lot of times people, you know, they're trying to emulate a voice.
Yes.
Or they're thinking about working on a TV show, so they're thinking, I need to match the voice of the show. So that's kind of their attitude of what they're doing. So what are some ways people can kind of hone in on their own individual voice and strengthen that?
Well, it's funny, you actually said probably the thing I would have led with, which is stop trying to emulate someone else's voice. You know, I think it really requires a lot, first of all, a lot of introspection. You know, ask yourself, why am I doing this? What got me into writing? What made me want to become a writer? Because fundamentally, it has to do with having something to say. What do I have to say? What are the subject matters I want to write about? What are the characters I'm drawn to? That's sort of the subtextual thing. And then there's a textual thing of just the actual like dialogue, like, you know, the way your voice as a writer sounds like. I mean, Aaron Sorkin being maybe the best example. Like, okay, well, that's clearly Aaron Sorkin. But for him, it's the rhythm and the music of writing. Of you know, hearing dialogue. You know, David Milch also has a very specific dialogue kind of voice. And I think that is really, again, it's introspection, and it's like, I like this. This feels good. When I write this way, it feels good to me. It's pleasing. I guess to be very reductive about it is, write to please yourself. And that's a good path to discovering your voice. You know, I got into writing, in large part, I realize in hindsight, because I like spending time with this guy in my head who is so much smarter than me. And, you know, writing like a line that I would think, oh, I would never be able to come up with that. But it came out of my, you know, my hands when I typed it. That I wanted to do more of that, you know, and I would, you know, try to cultivate that and hear that voice.
That's, it's so nice to hear, because I think that it can be scary to listen to that voice, because it's not emulating someone else. It's not saying, oh, this is a successful person, so if I write like them, then my chances are better. It's really honoring what you know, exactly what you said yourself. You know, what makes me happy when I write it on the page?
Yes, exactly. And by the way, you can be inspired by people. Like, there's a lot of writers who I'm inspired by. And a lot of times when I'm facing the blank page, I'll pick a script by a writer I admire and sort of read a few pages, sort of like a tuning fork, I call it. Like, it's like, it makes me excited to write. It's like, ooh, I want to do more along those lines. But it's about, you know, but that's all in service of my own voice, not trying to emulate someone else's. You know, you can be inspired by other people's voices as long as you're true to your own.
Yeah, I think that's so important, and it's something I don't think a lot of aspiring writers really think about. Thank you for.
Oh yeah, I think the ability to emulate someone else's voice, that I always describe that as, that's a neat parlor trick, you know, but that's not the thing that you can build a career on.
Mm-hmm. And I guess one kind of final wrap-up question, so I don't take too much of your time. I'm curious, because you kind of had, you had a life before,
yes,
you know, writing. And you've done...
I was a lawyer, so it wasn't much of a life.
Well, no, but with that being said, you know, I think that that's also something that lends itself to having a fuller writing experience when you actually live your life, you do other things, you experience other things. Do you have anything to kind of add to that? Is it important for people, you know, should they just be focused on their writing and that's all that they're doing? Should they do other things? Like, I mean, what's your kind of take on that? Do you have any?
Well, I think when you go back to voice, you know, it, again, it's having something to say. The more life experience you have, the more, I think, things you'll have to say. And, you know, if you look at, like, all the A-list screenwriters, quite frankly, there's a reason they're in their 40s. In an ageist business, like their 40s and their 50s, like the script doctors who get paid $250,000 for 2 weeks worth of work, like, you know, yes, there's always the wunderkind who's like in their 20s, but the truth of the matter is most of these men and women have lived lives, and there's a reason for that, that it shows up in their writing. It's not just experience being a professional writer, it's also experience being a human being.
Yeah, and I like to just, I like that, because I think that that's encouraging to people, because it's like, you know, just because you haven't made it by a certain point doesn't mean that it's, that's it, you know,
no.
Use all of that.
Yeah, I mean,
take
you
it and
take
use
it and
too.
Use it and, yeah. And you know, let it inform your writing. And there's no, you can, it's not, the you know, it's not a given that you have to be in your 20s when you, you know, I broke in when I was 29, you know, which was at the time very late, you know, compared to a lot of other people who'd been doing it forever and who had, you know, gone straight out of college into writing. I think life experience is very, very key, and it's one of the things I look for when I'm staffing up a show. It's like, give me people who are sort of experienced in doing something more than just, you know, writing scripts or reading scripts.
That's great. I think that's good news for any aspiring writer. So no matter what age, you know, you've got time. So thank you so much for your time.
Oh, my pleasure.
And I hope
this
that you
fun.
Have a good rest of your evening and weekend.
Thank you.
Yes, and we are with Scripts and Scribes.